bit about myself. Now, Helen will always refer to me as Trooper Mike. I've been retired from the Maryland State Police now for almost 2 years. I'm a civilian pilot for the Maryland State Police, so I was fortunate enough to be hired back as a helicopter pilot. I fly fixed wing and the helicopters. I'm the safety management pilot now. I'm a project manager because we're looking at going to a Part 135 operation as well, and that's the reason why I have so much gray hair at this time. But nonetheless, I'm was a trooper pilot from 1986 to 2014, retired June 30th. So July 1st, I had to take 45 days off before I could be hired back. So I came back and I'm a civilian pilot now. I'm the safety management pilot, as I mentioned. I am ATP rated, an airplane single engine multi, as well as helicopter. And I have my CFI airplane, single engine, multi-engine, as well as helicopter. CFI, CFII, like John, I'm a designated examiner as well for the Baltimore FISDO, as is Frank Phillips and Glenn and Neil up at Advanced. So there's a whole bunch of us around here that do this type of thing, and we're all happy and glad to be able to do it. What I'd like to do today is basically go through a brief history of the Maryland State Police Aviation Command, talk about the operational profiles, and we're going to focus on the air medical transport, or the air ambulance as they like to call it now, although we do certainly a lot more than just that. The flight crew complement and the aircraft, okay, which of course the AW-139 is the newest aircraft that we have. It replaced our legacy helicopter, which is the Dolphin helicopter. I'm sure everyone's familiar with that whine. Okay, it really wasn't our paramedics. It was actually from the aircraft. You know, we said when the whine was extensive, we thought it was the paramedics having to get off the couch, you know, to go save somebody's life. But it really was the Fenestron that had 11 blades. Okay, the AW-139 actually isn't as loud for as big as it is as the 139, which is pretty remarkable for, you know, being a large aircraft. We also have a Beach 300, which is the King Air 350. Okay, we utilize that as well, and a Cessna P210. And you might be asking yourself, well, what the hell do they do with a Cessna P210? I'd like to find that answer myself, okay, you know, because it really isn't suited for what we do, okay. We'll talk about that in just a second. As far as we can do mechanics back and forth, that certainly is okay there, but we certainly don't fly to altitudes that require pressurization. And then lastly, we'll take any questions that you might have, okay. Little history. October 1960, we started out with a Hiller. I mean, we actually started back in the early 50s with an airplane, but as far as the helicopters are concerned, 1960 was our start. And the old Hiller there, as you can see, you can barely see it now, but the trooper in there has his Stetson on. Okay, he actually had his hat, because even by the time I retired, I don't think it's changed much. You had to have that hat on. Okay, whenever you're outside and you see a trooper alongside the road writing a citation or giving, you know, someone some instructions, so to speak, then you'll notice that they always have their Stetson. Even then, they flew the helicopter with it on. How they got the headset over, I don't know, but of course they didn't have those headsets. The first medevac was actually completed March 19th, 1970 at 11:20. And we utilized a Jet Ranger. So through the 60s, we migrated to the Bell Jet Ranger. And then just a month or so ago, we celebrated our 46th year with over 148,000 lives saved. But of course, like anything else, there's a price. And the price was the loss of several crews, okay? Starting out with the first loss, which occurred in 1961, was actually an airplane. This particular trooper had an airplane, was helping the state police, or working with this. He's a state trooper, but he was assisting using his own, an airplane that he had access to when he had his accident on takeoff. And then TFC Russ and Oil in 1972, weather related, as it was in 1973. 1986 was the accident that precipitated the purchase of the Dolphin helicopters. Okay. And then lastly, and most recently, was September 27, 2008, the night where civilian pilot Steve Bunker and Mickey Lippi had a were involved in a fatal accident as well. But it wasn't just them this time. Prior to that, it was MSP personnel. But we also lost Miss Tanya Mallard, who was the fuel provider, because we took an extra fuel provider for the second patient that we had. Miss Ashley Younger, who was the one of the victims of the car accident, and Miss Jordan Wells, who was actually a survivor of the accident. At the time of the accident, we can talk about this a little bit later, now that everything's been litigated, okay, we can talk a little more freely about it. But basically, Steve, the pilot on the right side, was ejected out, which allowed, I think, Jordan to be forced out of the aircraft enough to where she wasn't crushed. And fortunately for her, she did survive, albeit she did lose a leg. Regrettably, that's the price sometimes we pay. No one intends to have accidents, but it happens. And we do our best, as you do. Everyone, aviators here, pilots, okay, just interested participants here. But you know, no one goes out trying to have an accident. It doesn't work that way. It's just a combination of events that anyone removed would prevent the accident. But sometimes we don't break that accident chain, and the accident still occurs, and there's a loss of life, and we certainly have had our share. The mission statement, obviously you always have a mission statement associated with any organization: to protect and improve the quality of life through the airborne delivery of emergency medical, law enforcement, and search and rescue services to the citizens of Maryland and its neighbors 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Understanding that we're the only state in the contiguous 48 states that have a 24/7 system, where you know, you're in Maryland, you're hurt in a traumatic event, accident, something of that nature, you'll get a flight by the Maryland State Police, okay, to the hospital. And again, that's pretty impressive. Now, we're a public and civil aircraft operator. Does anyone know the difference between the two, public and civil? I mean, we know the CFR is Part 91, Part 135, right? Part 61 for certification. Does anyone have any idea about the public aircraft statutes? Okay, well, basically what that does is it allows a public entity, first you have to meet the definition, and it's a public entity. Well, we're a public entity, Maryland State Police. Maryland State, the state of Maryland, bought the aircraft for the Maryland State Police to operate. So that makes it, it fits part of the definition. And you have to do something that is associated with a government entity or a government service. And if you remember back in the early 90s, they were talking about all the giveaway helicopters, the surplus helicopters and the like. Well, the commercial vendors who made these helicopters got a little upset that they were giving away Hueys, that they were giving away, you know, Bell 206 helicopters, or the TH-27, the Navy variant of it, and the like, the Loaches, which are the 500. So they got a little upset by that. So they developed a statute that stated, okay, well, yeah, you can use these, but you can only use them for certain things. And they defined those certain things. Search and rescue, law enforcement, disaster assessment, homeland security now, were all those type of things. And the air ambulance, we know it as medevac, and then it evolved to helicopter EMS transports, and now air ambulance, because it has a little bit different connotation. Okay, medevac is mission-oriented. You know, everyone thinks of MASH in Korea, and they wanted to take that away from what we do. They wanted to wanted it to be a definition of basically taking someone that needs to go to a hospital in an expedited fashion. That it wasn't a hot LZ, it wasn't an extraction or anything of that nature. So verbiage was important, and they changed it. So now it's called helicopter air ambulance. But it fit the criteria of a government activity or a public activity. Now, that being said, as I mentioned, owned by a government, a governmental function, must adhere to the regulations regarding national airspace. So we can't bust airspace, we can't go into restricted areas, without the clearance and those things. So there's certain things that we still have to adhere to as well. And the aircraft need not have airworthiness certificate. So they get them from the military, they don't have an airworthiness certificate because the Army, the Navy, the Marines, they're a government entity as well. So we can operate those in a limited function, in fashion. We can't do any civil operation with an aircraft that's purely a public use aircraft. And you'll see that now referred to as a POA, a PAO, a public aircraft operator, a public aircraft operation. Now, these are two examples of purely public use aircraft that we had, the 58 and the Huey. They did not have airworthiness certificates. They were not certificated for any civil operation, but we could use it for search and rescue. We could use it to hoist or to do fast roping, things of those natures, which again are classified as public aircraft operations. So we certainly could use those. Now, to be sure, the Maryland State Police always maintain their aircraft to the standards set forth in CFR 43 or as required. We've never operated an aircraft unairworthy because we were a governmental entity. And that's an important distinction. Any aircraft that we fly is airworthy, to say the least. Civil aircraft now, of course. This is the other end of this spectrum. Part 91, Part 135, flight instruction, anything of that nature, has to have an airworthiness certificate. In order to maintain the airworthiness certificate, you have to have the required inspections, an annual 100-hour if it's used for commercial purposes, transponder, pitot-static, and all those. Has to be completed on the aircraft. Pilots have to be certificated and meet all currency requirements outlined in Part 61. And all the equipment has to be TC'd or STC'd by the FAA. And we can't charge, or you can't charge for services unless you're operating under Part 135. So, and we'll talk about how the Maryland State Police is funded here briefly in just a moment. But you have an understanding of the distinction between a public aircraft operator and a civil operator, because it's an important distinction. Now, the multi-purpose, that's one of the things after the crash in 1986, we went from that public aircraft operator per se, okay, to more of a multi-purpose function where one helicopter can do all those things. It can do the search and rescue. It can do the, as I said, the rappelling. We did rappelling before. Law enforcement, Homeland Security, aerial plant. We can do all that with one helicopter. And that started with the Dolphin helicopters. Of course, you're all familiar that the Coast Guard utilizes. It was a double H-65. Ours was the AS-365, and we had an M1, N2, and N3 model, all of them with different cockpits. Anyone get into different aircraft with switchologies that are different? Well, you can imagine 3 o'clock in the morning getting a call and just swapping into another helicopter and saying, oh my gosh, where is this? And going through that. So that posed a problem to begin with. Fortunately, we didn't have any issues that we know of, okay? Maybe that accident chain had been broken at some point by someone saying, well, wait a minute, okay, let me take a second here before we roll out the door to remember what aircraft I'm in. But nonetheless, it was a problem, and it was recognized as a problem when we procured the AW-139, which is the aircraft on the right, both of them doing the same mission. But again, a multi-purpose helicopter that's both public and civilian. And that's another distinction. That means that our aircraft, we can do the public stuff. We can do the helicopter air ambulance. We can do the search and rescue. We can do all that because everything on the, and then take the governor, which would be not a public aircraft operation, but a civil movement. If we took the governor from Martin State to Ocean City, okay, that would be a civil operation under Part 91. Now, if we had a pure public aircraft, as I mentioned earlier before, that had pieces of equipment that weren't certificated on that aircraft, then we wouldn't be legal to do that. And it's not really a public event if he's going to make a speech. There's no necessity in that. There's no governmental need that he gets there in that timely fashion. But with an aircraft that's certificated under Part 61 or Part 43 and holds an airworthiness certificate, we can do both. And that was the intent here. Okay, so the Dolphin was the first aircraft could do a multi-mission that was completely certificated under Part 43. It was a progressive inspection process that they used, but airworthiness certificate, annual inspection, PETA, all that was done. Everything on it had been certificated by the FAA either through the STC or the TC process, and TC is the type certification process. And the same was is true with the AW139. As a matter of fact, it was procured with that in mind. Now, other multi-purpose aircraft that we have would be the King Air 350, as I mentioned, and the 210. The 350, even though we carry a bad guys from one spot to the to another, that is still considered a public operation. But the aircraft is completely certificated under Part 43. It's on a progressive inspection. All the inspections are completed. All the ADs are complied with and the like. The 210, the same thing holds true with that. Now, back to that pressurized 210. Initially, the thought was, well, you know, the King Air, two engines, 900 pounds an hour, okay, lots of fuel. Well, what about the tri-state if we had to pick up a bad guy from South Carolina, North Carolina? But then it quickly became obvious that we didn't want someone in the back that was coming to Baltimore to stand trial for a murder charge that close to the flight crew in the front.
Right.
Besides leaving bodily fluids in the back and getting everyone's attention because they really didn't care whether they made it there or not, it was soon realized that, well, maybe we shouldn't be using it for that. And basically what we do now with is we move mechanics around to air helicopters to make sure that we can keep them serviced. We sometimes, we all remember Governor Glendinning, he used it quite a bit, okay, while he exercised spend his time in the in Annapolis. So it got in and out of Lee Airport quite nicely, okay, for a pretty slick aircraft. So they too are considered. Now, anyone here get pulled over by an aircraft doing VASCAR? Ever remember seeing those signs, you know, enforcement by aircraft? Well, man, you guys are unlucky, I'm telling you, because we did that so rarely to begin with. And then we got into a jam because we had a 182 before we got the one, the 210, and we had the VASCAR, right? And we put it in there, and it wasn't supplementally type certificated for that airplane, but public aircraft, right? We can do that. But then we put people to move them, and the FAA said, well, what are you doing? Well, we're moving mechanics. Well, they said, well, you got that piece of equipment in there, it's not certificated. You can't do that. So we got our hands slapped, had to pull it out, and there went the airborne speed enforcement program. So it hasn't happened. So if you get pulled over, someone says they got you from a VASCAR, from an airplane, wasn't us. Now maybe Virginia, because we know they'll write anybody. Okay, they'll go out, they'll go cross borders to write somebody a citation. So even troopers do the speed limit when they go through Virginia. So. And we got that get out of jail card free, I guess, but or retired troopers, I should say. I won't be clear on that because I am being recorded here. But anyway, they also do the two missions as well. The flight crews, as I mentioned, even though we can operate a public aircraft and not be certificated, think about the military, the Army. Okay, they train their pilots. They certificate their pilots to fly. They don't have an FAA certificate until they go to the FAA. And request one, okay, based on their training. So we don't, but we don't have to have it when we're operating. But if we're going to do a civil mission and a government public aircraft operation, then certainly we need to be. And we've always used certificated pilots. All of them have to have an ATP or commercial pilot with an instrument rating, and now a AW139, 2,000 hours in helicopters. That's not just flight time; it's helicopter flight time, which is extremely difficult to get and expensive if you're not in the military. So it's not something that's done overnight. It is incredible. As a matter of fact, in 1986, I was the last pilot hired by the Maryland State Police that had less than 2,000 hours. Prior to the accident in 1986, in January 1986, the pilots were actually brought in with minimum time and trained in the Maryland State Police helicopters doing the Maryland State Police mission. And I really believe we had a pretty good product. But after 1986, a weather-related accident that had nothing to do with the helicopter, obviously as most accidents, I think, can be, you know, reasons for accidents can be contributed to pilot error. You had an HSI, it got caught into fog. Of course, the terrain rises, fog stays where it is. And then the military folks train them to do that 180. Now, of course, we know when we're in that position to do the 180 before you get into the inadvertent IMC situation, or if you're in it, to maintain control of the aircraft first, right? Climb the aircraft with no big changes, unless you have equipment that you can use like an autopilot. Now, this the Jet Rangers didn't have autopilots, but they would have broken out as opposed to winding up in Lincoln Park. But nonetheless, we got 12 Dolphin helicopters based on that accident. Was the impetus for that? IFR equipped, and then the requirement was 2,000 hours with an instrument rating. Okay, so. Not only did we purchase, before we purchased the helicopters, we had to get everyone instrument rated. So you can imagine in 1986, between 1987 and 1989, when we took delivery of the first Dolphin helicopter, there was a lot of work and a lot of training to be done. But now we use two pilots since the 2008 accident. And the airframe that we're flying now, I think in January of 2012, ultimately, when we first did our training in the aircraft, a decision was made by the command that, hey, we need to be two pilots. There's no one else that flies the AW-139 in a single pilot fashion. LA Fire does on occasion, okay, depending on the situation. But any of the corporate folks that own this helicopter, there's a number of them out there. Under Armour, as a matter of fact, okay, has AW-139s as well. And they fly with two pilots. So it just makes perfect sense that we have two pilots. The SIC, it has to be commercial rated in 1,200 flight hours in helicopters. Now, 1,200 is key because anyone, again, familiar with the 135 regulations, in order to be a co-pilot, or I should say a PIC in instrument conditions, you have to have at least 1,200 hours under 135. So now what you're seeing is something we haven't had before either, is a career ladder. So instead of bringing new people in, okay, and vetting them, okay, we now can bring them in as an SIC, and then they can work their way from the left seat, okay, in the helicopter to the right seat, which is the PIC side. So it really does, it gives us it was a lot of growing pain. Of course, we went from a single pilot, a single paramedic flight crew, to two pilots. We'll talk about the paramedics in a second, but we got two of them now too. Okay, so it's now, we went from two to four. So you can imagine the training with the new helicopters it took to get everyone up to the same speed. And most of the pilots are now civilian. There's only two or three that are still the trooper pilots that are still sworn members of the Maryland State Police organization assigned to the Maryland State Police Aviation Command. Now the paramedics, okay? Designated as crew chief, that's the name du jour for now, okay? You know, I gotta hit them up a little bit. They're nationally registered EMTPs, so they can, you know, they not only cut clothes off for no reason, they can shove things in your nose and do all kind of things to you that are hopefully going to get you to the hospital in a stabilized fashion, okay, to where you have an opportunity to survive a pretty difficult situation.
What's the P?
Paramedic. That's what the P stands for. So it's a step above. They can do a number of things basically, and help me, John, with this, put you to sleep, or what do they got, do the intubation thing where they can shove stuff down your throat? Right, so the number of things they can do with the orders from the physicians at the Shock Trauma Center, Johns Hopkins, are one of the primary hospitals that they go to. And they're all MSP troopers, so they're all state police. As are the rescue technicians. Now, again, you see a career ladder, so we're finally getting to the point where there's some succession planning going on, okay, which is a good thing. So the rescue technician is the second provider that we would often bring from the scene when we only had one paramedic on the aircraft. So we have a trained individual that's working towards becoming a paramedic and moving over to become a crew chief as well. So again, it's really great. And that there's a career ladder and we can vet them as well, and then make sure that the crew coordination is working well. What else do they do? They do a lot, believe me. back in the day before we had the rescue tech, we would go out, of course, the pilot would strap in and they would pull us out. We would start the aircraft, they'd have to make sure all the doors are closed. Then they would get in, they would strap in, and they would set the GPS up and we would take off, and then they would help us clear the area before we would land, because we land in those, you see the big night sun, and we would light it up, and they would, yeah, we like this, and they would communicate with the fuel providers while we flew the aircraft, and we would bring it into landing, and then their work started. And then they landed, they get out, and they open it up, they go take care of the patient, make sure the patient's assessed, bring the patient back in, close it back up, getting back, and then off to the hospital we went, but still involved situationally to know, you know, hey, we got three green, you know, I can't tell you how many times the pilots have been saved by just a paramedic saying, hey, we got the gear down this time, you know. Fred, oh yeah, sure we do. And they sort of put it down and they land with no consequence. So again, this is just a few of the things. Now, with two pilots in the front, we have two in the back. They're as busy in the back, okay, because they're really taking care of the mission portion of the flight with regard to the law enforcement, that type of thing, if they don't have a patient on board. And we can speak to that more in just, towards the end. But they do manage the flare, the searchlight. We can downlink now with the new aircraft. There's a number of different things. They coordinate with the ground providers to make sure that that the location that we're landing is safe. We all have night vision goggles now, so they wear night vision goggles as well. And I'm an old night shift pilot, and I started to fly with the goggles, and I am just, I was so nervous after flying with them, because all those years that I flew without them and couldn't see, didn't know what I didn't know. You know, you go with the gut instinct, oh, it doesn't feel good, doesn't look good, you know, something's not right, let's go somewhere else, type of thing. Well, we've done that. Well, now we can see why we would have that feeling every once in a while. But again, the paramedics in the back, they're always clearing us and making sure that the aircraft is safe as well. So a very important couple people in the back of the aircraft, to say the least. Again, this is what we do. Scene trauma, scene medical, interfacility, and neonatal transfers. Now, basically, we're tasked with the scene trauma or scene medical. Someone gets hurt, someone has a heart attack, and you know, we're part of the STEMI program. We get certain patients to certain hospitals as well. But we don't routinely do the interfacility. Now, this is what happens if you should have a problem and you go to your local hospital and they need to get you to Johns Hopkins. Okay, if it's not trauma related, generally the Maryland State Police won't fly you for that. Okay, and this is where you get the bill from the commercial operator that will certainly take your breath away. Okay, now we do the neonate transports. Anyone familiar with Easton? We do a lot of work there. So we've taken, you know, babies just at the very minimum number of weeks that they can sustain life, and we've gotten them to Johns Hopkins, you know, by putting them in the isolate, if you would, and then putting them on board the aircraft, taking off the helipad, and getting them to Hopkins in about 30 minutes or so. So that is our what we do, okay? And that's 80% of what we do, with the other 20% being the law enforcement, the search and rescue, and the like. Here's the man. He's the one that started the concept back in the late 60s, as I had mentioned, early 70s, when we prior to doing that first air medical transport. R. Adams Colley was the one that looked at the studies in Korea and how shock was the biggest problem with the injury that people were succumbing to, and if they got them to the hospital in a 60-minute time frame, that they generally would survive their injuries, or at least the shock portion, because they got them to a suitable area. And that's where the golden hour concept basically came from. What a gentleman. He got then Governor Mandel to work with him, and they had to identify someone that would do the transports, and said, well, we just happen to have the Maryland State Police, who just happen to have a helicopter. Will that work for you? And again, the discipline of the Maryland State Police. And then, of course, we went from the Heller to the Jet Ranger, and then we started business in 1970. And it works well. Now, it's an interesting little side here. as I mentioned, all the paramedics are well trained. They go to the trauma center, they go to Johns Hopkins, they go to the cadaver lab, they do all kind of things. It's really pretty neat. The last time I saw Dr. Calley was at a meeting that he held, a luncheon he held for everyone. So there's a table of pilots and paramedics, and we're all scattered when one of our pilots got up and started to show the classic sign of choking. And he's had a piece of sandwich in his throat, and he's doing this. Well, as all the medics were laughing at him, one of the pilots, Dick Bruns, got up, walked behind him, and this is right in front of Dr. Calley. Dr. Calley was sitting there and did the Heimlich, and a piece of sandwich was expelled, and you know, he turned white again, pink, and all that good stuff. The pilot just sat down like no big deal, and the medics just sort of looked at him. Okay, so again, it's sometimes, you know, the pilots, we do fly, but every once in a while we have to jump into action to save our own. Okay, we thought that was probably part of the reason that he wasn't a medic, that they weren't all that interested in helping us out there, but nonetheless, but what a gentleman he was. And and we have the legacy of the program to honor his memory. Now, how do we do this? How do we get the people from, you know, an area of trauma and accident, if you would, to Baltimore? Well, we do it through seven bases. Now, prior to the 2008 accident, we had eight. Okay, we had 12 Dauphine helicopters for eight sections, which worked out well. Now, again, pretty small state. Okay, to have this many helicopters, and you might say, well, we got Cumberland, there can't be all that many people up there, but those people pay taxes as well. So we have to supply them with the same service that we supply folks on the Eastern Shore, folks in Harford County, Cecil County as well. But this map basically came along shortly after the 2008 accident when he had a base realignment. We went from Centerville, which you're all familiar with, to Easton because there was an ILS there, okay? It became very important that we have a place to go in the event that we get caught in IMC conditions. And again, what we do right now, it's obvious, can't be done in instrument conditions. When you go to Route 50 and 301, there's no instrument approach there for those folks that aren't pilots or aviators. There's no way of getting down safely. You have to be able to see visually to do this. Now, things are changing that way, we'll discuss in a few minutes. But right now, that's the case. So we have helicopters strategically positioned, okay, throughout the state of Maryland. So we have those resources. Now we have 10 helicopters servicing seven sections. And the new helicopters are fantastic. They're all electronic. Anyone has ever buy something new and have difficulty electronically with it, little tweaks here. Well, we've been going through those for the last 3 years. So we're tweaking things, we're getting used to the equipment, we're getting used to repairing them. And we're finding it, we're somewhat difficult to keep seven sections up with 10 helicopters. But we're doing it. We also have Delaware State Police that helps us, you know, with reciprocity. We help them, they help us. The same with Park Police, who does a great job for us whenever our Trooper 2 is down. Park Police helps us out if we need to get a transport as well. Now, of course, Trooper 6, which services this area, is right out of Easton. Again, we would have had that helicopter here if the weather had been a little bit better. So, the AW-139 helicopter is the helicopter that we use. It was purchased, 10 of them were purchased, with the option of buying two more, because remember we had 12 for eight. But they decided, well, these are much newer, much better, maybe we can get away with 10. And that's what we're doing now. We're getting away with 10, okay? So we're having some difficulty. In October 2012, Governor O'Malley basically signed a contract. They were procured for us by MDOT, Maryland Department of Transportation, working with the Maryland State Police, okay, to spec out the helicopters. And then everything was great. We were supposed to get the first two helicopters in spring of 2011 it was signed, that's off there. In spring of 2012, okay. So the contract was actually signed in 2011. That's an error there. I apologize for that. But they weren't ready. Now, by saying they weren't ready, some of the equipment that we chose to put on it had not been completely certificated. And remember, we have to have everything certificated, either TC, DETS type certificated by the FAA, as by the manufacturer, everything's approved, or STC. So we had to wait. We're not going to take a helicopter that has not been fully certificated by the FAA to meet those standards. And they said, okay, well, we'll store them up for you. Well, come February 2013, we got six of them at once. Okay, now, that meant six warranties started at the same time and not two every 3 months. So some unintended consequences that we had to work through, because we fly these aircraft quite a bit. And trying to schedule the servicing and the maintenance, it became a nightmare and a logistical nightmare. We got the last one, the 10th helicopter, in 2014, September 2014. But they were all procured to be the same. If you went to Cumberland and sat in their helicopter, or you went to Baltimore at Martin State, or you went to Frederick in Frederick Airport, or you went to Southern Maryland, or down here to Salisbury, you'd see the same helicopter inside, either the cockpit or the cabin area, the same exact helicopter. And they were procured that way for that reason. We learned from the Dolphins that we can't have folks doing that. It was just ripe for an accident to occur. So that's one of the great things. We paid $12.2 million. You paid $12.2 million, and we do thank you for that. Okay. Now, that's a great deal. And if you remember back in October of 2011, when the governor actually made this announcement, he basically shoved his thumb in Governor Christie's eye, saying that they paid $1 million more than we did for less of a helicopter. But what he didn't know was the New Jersey State Police gave us a lot of the intel that we needed to get and bargain to get that price. So shortly thereafter, the lieutenant that helped us out a lot was reassigned. And again, unintended consequences of political stuff. But New Jersey paid $13.2 million. Now here's the other part to this. Contractually, we're done in 2016, July, June 30th. So if the governor went to August and said, we want those two, we want those options, it would be 12.2. They'd have to give us the same exact helicopter. On July 1st, they don't have to give us the same exact helicopter, and it would be about $18.5 million. Would you like to be in that room when someone says, you mean we could have bought it $6 million cheaper? The reports have gone upstream suggesting that we might look at this. Now, one of the things that we did do as well is they procured a flight training device, a W-139 flight training device, level 6, which is pretty sophisticated, NVG capable, so we can do a lot of our training and checking in at up to 75%. We can't do the actual touchdowns and landings in the air, in the flight training device, but it will help us. But we don't have it yet. We're not probably going to be able to get that until sometime this fall. And then it has to be certificated, and we know how that goes. So again, it's in the works. But it's a great aircraft, and we did really get a pretty good price on the helicopters based on the hard work of MDOT and the Maryland State Police Aviation Command. Some specifics on the helicopter itself. The way it sits, it's heavy, 10,700 pounds, basic empty weight. It's got a max takeoff weight of not 19,000, it should be 14,991. I'm going to have to talk to my staff. Staff, you're looking at him, me, myself, and I. But it's actually 14,991 is the max takeoff weight. Generally, it's 6,800 kilograms. We have the 6,800 kilogram kit for it. Basically, the aircraft, we try to keep it around 14,112 pounds, which is around 6,400 kilograms. Anybody here take the metric stuff in high school? Because I didn't do well in it, and I'm still having trouble with it. But everything from the Italians is in centimeters and millimeters and kilograms. It's just making me crazy. Power plants, Pratt Whitney PT6 67 Charlie engines. These engines are powerful. Less than 300 pounds, over 1,600 shaft horsepower. They can actually hover the aircraft on one engine, which is unheard of for a helicopter. I mean, it's just incredible power plant. We have a four-axis autopilot. John's an airline pilot for a number of years with the auto thrust, auto throttle. I mean, this thing, you push a button and it hovers itself. It really does. It's incredible. We just did a LPV approach into Easton and back into Martins, and hands-off approach, just like an airliner would. It's basically it's an air transport aircraft. It's a it's got an Epic Primus flight management system, which is on a number of Gulfstream airplanes. I mean, these are pretty extensive, sophisticated pieces of equipment, and they really do a great job. And the other thing is up to a nine degree glide slope. That's pretty impressive. We generally, for those that are instrument rated, 3 degrees is about the norm. With this helicopter, we can do that. And believe it or not, we have one right here, a special instrument approach procedure at the Queen Anne's Emergency Department here. And you can't see it here, but it's actually a 5.3 degree glide slope on that LPV approach. Now, what we're getting to is moving from a pure VFR operation to incorporating more of an IFR element to it. And this is important because it means we can get more people to the hospital in that golden hour time frame. So the idea is, once we get the aircraft all upgraded and all the training to where right now the aircraft have not been updated for the LPV. Contractually, it was supposed to be done when we first got the helicopters, but it didn't play well with some of the other systems we had, so they finally made that fix. So we have that capability now in three of our aircraft. Once we get all 10, it won't be uncommon for us to be able to go from an airport to where there's an accident on 50 in Easton, and it's the weather is marginal like it is today, and they simply take the patient to the hangar at Easton or to the emergency department here at Queen Anne's, right here off of 50. And then we do the instrument approach. We load the patient on at Easton Airport, or we land over here at Queen Anne's emergency department, put the patient on, do the departure procedure out, do a GPS approach, hop on one of the GPS routes that they're developing for helicopters. And any instrument rated pilots here? Any of you see the TK? Okay, there are the helicopter approaches or GPS routings that use the WAS capability. So a lot of these are going to be a lot lower, because right now we can't really mix it up with the airplanes because we get into the icing. They're not certified for icing. So if we have a patient on board and we go into a position where they really got to get to Baltimore, and the weather's getting skosh, and we know if we go ahead and file, which we can do, we can get into the system, we're not guaranteed we're not going to be delayed. Because if there's an airliner that's en route, and just because we're lifeguard, it's an IFR-controlled environment, they may not be able to get us direct to the trauma center, or we might get in a position where it'd be unsafe. So right now, the pilot and the paramedic might decide to try to scud run, as opposed to doing what they should do and get into the system, because they're thinking about the patient in the back. In that scenario, they got to think about the flight crew, okay? And that will alleviate that. So you can see, even though we do off-the-road stuff, we can incorporate some of the IFR stuff into it now that we couldn't before. Now, a lot of the commercial operators that do the hospital-to-hospital transports, they're faced with a very similar problem. Okay, it's easier for them to get into the IFR system on warm days. Their patients really aren't traumatic. They're basically packaged patient that needs to get to another facility for better care. But it's not a golden hour flight, so to speak. So we can't take that chance. So a lot of times, if we have an opportunity to fly some IFR during the winter months, say from Salisbury to Baltimore, Cumberland to Baltimore, where it would really be beneficial, we have to consider the icing and things of that nature. So generally, we won't take those flights. Whereas with the low en route GPS infrastructure that's being developed with the FAA by the Maryland State Police, we're going to do it a lot more. They have capability now of basically doing a GPS route right over 70. Okay, at very low minimum en route altitudes, and really will increase the amount of patients that we can transport. Again, it's very exciting, because as I'd mentioned, all but three of one of our fatal accidents was in one way or another a weather-related accident. Okay, a lot of bad decisions. We had one mechanical accident that caused the fatality, but the rest were basically human error. So that would prevent a lot of it. So it's real exciting. So up to a 9 degree slope is pretty steep, to say the least. And 5 degrees here. And if anybody, next time you go by Queen Anne's, take a look at how confined that area is. And we have a special instrument approach procedure that we can utilize there. So that's one part of it. Easton has one now at their, and they're modifying their helipad to support the AW139 as well.
What are the men's on those approaches?
Say again?
What are the men's on
ILS, their precision, like 250, 300 feet. It's incredible. So, I mean, this is a basically, it's considered an approach with vertical guidance, but it is precision-like. And we know as examiners that it will even satisfy the precision approach criteria for an instrument rating. So they're pretty interesting approaches. So here's the AW139. I know you'd rather have it outside, as would I. It makes a much better prop than this. But it's quite impressive. What you're seeing there is the track of searchlight. Okay, again, 30 million candle power. It's this bright. The technology is a lot better than the other searchlight we had, which would get diffuse as you open it up. But this really beams it in pretty well. And we have the a capability, now maybe based on what I said, I don't have anything to give. I'll give you one of my patches. I know John stole a lot before he left, I'm sure. But we have what's called the infrared lens on it. And the FAA says you can't use that because you may hurt someone's eyes. Now, the neat thing about that is that we can use that and a bad guy would never know that light is on them. And then that coupled with our night vision goggles, we can be watching him on the camera that we have, which is this device here, the MX-15 camera, and he'd never know it. Because right now they see the light and they know, whoops, you know, somebody's watching me. But the FAA says, no, we can't use that. It hasn't been certificated for civil use. So we had to remove that in order for this thing. If not, we would have to remove the light in order to take say a mechanic or a neonate patient from the one hospital to the other. So again, we are very cautious in the way we do things. We do not, you know, want to violate any of the regulations because we can be fined as well as anyone else. And of course, you guys will be paying for our fines in one way or the other. Don't want that. The MX-15 camera, again, we had great technology in the Dolphins. We had the flare ball, and it was old, and John's very familiar with that. We didn't catch a lot of bad guys with it. We're catching a lot of bad guys with this. We've seen cars we've been called upon to see if a person, a bad guy, had a gun in the vehicle, and from about 3/4 mile out, about 1,500 feet, they were able to zoom in and see a shotgun in the front seat next to the guy that was suicidal.
That's
the
flare.
That's the camera and the flare. Well, at nighttime will be the flare, but the camera for the daytime operation. So we have, but the MX-15 has that capability as well. So it's not only a flare, a forward-looking infrared, okay, taking the differences in heat, but it also is a camera itself, a color camera. So, of course, and that's projected on the screen in the back or in our fifth display, which you'll see in just a second. So again, it's pretty massive, and you can see the legacy helicopters here. It sort of dwarfs it. I know it's up close, and it's a matter of perspective, but we have a couple of the legacy helicopters in the back, and you can see it's a massive aircraft. The hoist is on the right, so we still, that's part of our public aircraft mission. What I don't have highlighted here, because you really can't see it, are the rappelling bars. Okay, so they can, you know, the guys, that like to jump out of helicopters, perfectly good flying aircraft, and go down to help somebody out, they can do that. So we're set up for that, of course, which is a public aircraft, a flight operation as well. To side, again, you see another perspective. Conventional tail rotors, I mentioned, 4 blades as opposed to 11, you don't hear that whine. And the signature is a little bit different. You know, it's a little deeper. I don't think it's as aggravating, but it's still a conventional, but it's high enough to where we don't have an issue of an onlooker walking into the tail rotor. So it's pretty, it's about 8 foot high. So it's got a good safety, that's a good safety feature, to say the least. And then the Pratt Whitney engines, again, the downside, 145 gallons an hour, 1,000 pounds an hour. So it holds 419 gallons. It sucks it up. The happiest guy in the world is the guy in the tanker truck. He's just smiling away when he comes to Easton. He's smiling at Martins because he's there about every other day, okay, reloading the fuel, because we do suck up a lot of fuel in this aircraft. But other than that, it's great. The power is great. So we're looking at about 54 feet from the tip of the blade to the tail rotor, and about 45 for the rotor disc, which you can see here over the water. So it does take up some spot. And anyone here, you know, to think that helicopters don't produce wakes or downwash, this thing will blow you over. It will. It's interesting because when we transitioned into the helicopter, we went from section to section to section. And then as a safety management section, I would get reports of shingles being blown off of roofs and boats that fly, okay, and things of that nature, because guys were flying the way that they normally flew the Dolphins. And these reports were following the transitions all the way through. So we had boats that fly, we had roofs that came off, fences that were buckled, okay, by the downwash. So again, you'll see quite an area protected. Usually 150 by 150 feet is what we would like to see to do that. And most of the time what you see now is the aircraft comes almost straight over and hovers down with the doors open. So the paramedics actually will open the back door, and the rescue tech will open the back door, and they will look to clear. Okay, and then they see things flying. They say things are flying, and then they go around and come back and find someplace else to land. But it happens. The inside of the cockpit, again, it's all glass. The primary flight display, multifunction flight display, pilot, co-pilot have the same. It is type certificated for single pilot operations. But in the U.S., it's type certificated for two pilot IFR operations. So to fly in instrument conditions, you have to have two pilots in this country. And that was another contention, because we had to hire more pilots to do this. But again, it's such a the environment is so much safer with two pilots than it is with one in this operation. And what I did, and that's our fifth display, everything in the back of the helicopter at the, which you'll see is the mission console that we have, can be thrown up front to the pilots as well. So if the paramedics is back there looking up his girlfriend's address, okay, on the computer, he can send it up to the pilot and say, hey, we might want to fly over here, okay. I'm sure that's happened a few times. Or vice versa, because we do have a number of female paramedics as well. The overhead control panel, again, you know, just to give you an idea that this aircraft is like a transport category aircraft. It's got everything that you would expect a high-end, you know, Gulfstream or corporate jet to have. The cabin area where all the work is done, the configuration is basically paramedic would be, this is the mission console side, this is the rescue tech side, this is where the hoist station would be, okay. The LOSIS is the where the patient would go, the single patient. If we had two patients, there's room on the other side to put two patients. You'll see that in just a second. Okay, that's the actual mission console. Okay, that's where it would be. I thought that was a neat trick. John, did you like that? You say you like that? Okay, but that's actually what that would look like, and the seat would pull up, and that's where the paramedic would do his thing as far as the law enforcement aspect of it. Of course, any of the SAR missions would be on the opposite side. And again, in the back, we have a tunnel that's actually opened. That's something else that was a criteria. That wall can be removed so they can actually get into the baggage. One of the issues that we had with the legacy helicopters is that if we wanted to do a hoist, and again, that multi-mission capability, we would have to sit down to pull the litter or the Stokes basket, if you would, out of the back and to bring it into the front. Now, everything can be done in flight, and we don't have to land the aircraft. And you'll notice how we only have one seat back here. So if we had two patients, we would put another provider here if necessary. A lot of times if we have to fly a child, they'll bring the parent with us. And then the paramedic would be on this side and the rescue tech would be on the other side and provide the care. If there's two patients, the rescue tech would assist. Usually we don't take two priority ones at the same time for that reason, but we can take another person. And we often do if it's a juvenile. And this is just another side of view, and it's a massive entry. The egress points are the windows, which is a little disconcerting because you have to sort of push the windows out to get out. The doors would jam up, but designed to do so. We've lost a couple in flight already where they just get sucked off. That's a little disconcerting because they have to test it and they have to glue it back. If it's not set in properly and you're going 140 knots, it can come out pretty. It gets everybody's attention.
Mike, that mission console then?
Yes, sir.
Is that a portable unit then?
No, as you see right now, the chair is back up against it.
Okay, so now if that chair
was removed,
I gotcha. Okay.
That's what it would see, and the chair would slide up to it. For takeoff and landing, the actual back of the chair has to be facing forward so they don't get impaled by that. Or they have to move the seat back a little bit further. But they can do everything from there. They can work the flare, the MX-15, or the camera portion of it. They can use the tracker beam as well. And they really remove a lot of that mission stuff from the pilots in front who only basically have to fly now, which is great. So a division of attention. But as far as crew resource management is concerned, it's still one person, doesn't matter who that is. It could be a pilot, a SIC, a PIC, it could be a rescue tech, or a crew chief, or it could be our dispatcher can cancel the flight. If someone doesn't care for something, they can cancel the flight, and no one goes. Okay, again, it doesn't mean that one of the other six sections won't take it if they feel that they can do it safely. It's not helicopter shopping. It's just the way that we're running it. And that's important. So any person, any crew member or dispatcher can cancel a flight. No one can make a PIC take the flight.
Okay. Is that a partition between?
Yes. Partition here was actually part of the NVG capability. We had to be able to close that off. The back or the cabin is NVG compatible. The front has to be certificated for us to do it. But again, we have our paramedics in back with goggles on as well. And they're each $10,000 a copy. And they're certificated every 180 days as well. So again, that's compliant with CFR 135, Part 61 as well. Again, so we're really making that extra effort to make sure that we comply with all the regulations. Even technically, when we're operating as a public aircraft, we don't. So again, we're not taking any chances. And that's something that, I'm really proud of the way we operate that way. Because there are some folks, if something's inoperative on the aircraft, they turn their hat around and say, well, we're a public aircraft. We'll go ahead and take off. We have an MEL for this. We had an MEL for the Dauphine as well. And if something was not relieved by the MEL, the aircraft sat. It sat. And we don't turn a blade for a buck. We don't charge anyone. And that's what it looks like as far as a couple dummies here. Okay. As far as the second patient is concerned, that's the way it would look. In this case, but this was a demonstration for it. So we can actually fit two folks in there. So basically, just went through a quick history about the Maryland State Police, talked about some of the profiles and the complement. The aircraft, any questions about the AW139? Again, if you have an opportunity to go to Easton, okay, we're back by the tower, the new tower building across from Trident is hangar, and you'll see. Feel free to go in. It's your helicopter, okay? It's your helicopter. You fund it for us, and you have since the early 90s, okay? When they got the MSOL fund passed through, I forget the House bill, but basically part of your registration fee that you pay for your vehicles goes towards funding this operation. And it's pretty impressive when you take a look at the big picture. So that being said, and I think I'm on schedule, huh? Did you like that? Right on time. Are there any questions? Anything at all I can help you with?
So can they, are those monies fenced off so they can't, the legislators can't steal it to pay for whatever?
I wish. Okay, what happened? Okay. This MSOL fund basically is a big pot. Now, again, this is not just the Maryland State Police show. What you're hearing is my side of it. But understand, if it just helicopters, we wouldn't be able to help anybody because we wouldn't have the folks on the ground that respond to the scene, that make the determination,
right,
that do the triage, that call us, or the folks at the hospital. So we're just one cog in the wheel, okay? So that being said, the MSOL fund initially was in the early 90s to support the helicopters, okay, and to help with the EMS, Maryland EMS in general. But then, you know, a lot of the other partners also started to need new equipment and money started to come out of those funds. So 80% of our funding is through the MSOLF, and that's because 80% of what we do is helicopter air ambulance transports. Now, if that were to change, then of course we would, you know, the Maryland State Police would have to ante up more than that. But since the accident, our numbers have gone down because of the way the protocols that have been reviewed. So not everyone flies. The two patients that we lost, one a survivor, basically didn't need to be flown. Their injuries really weren't that extensive that were required, and that brought a whole lot of people really looked hard at who we fly and why we fly them. We have no fly zone, so to speak, now around Baltimore, for example. You know, we have this mecca of medical institutions in Maryland, you know, the trauma center, world-renowned trauma center, shock trauma center. We have Johns Hopkins, world-renowned. We have the Bayview Burn Center, also part of Johns Hopkins. We have Washington Hospital Center. We have some of the finest facilities in the world, but a lot of them, they can be driven to sometimes as fast as flown by the time we get the aircraft to the scene, and then the paramedics, and you know, they go ahead and assess the patient and we fly them a lot of times to get there. So they're actually took their time, an expert panel. In 2008, were impaneled, and then in 2009, they came up with a report and they talked about the protocol. They talked about the aircraft as well. Some of the recommendations were that we pursue Part 135 for the infrastructure. Okay. Also, that we comply with all the NTSB recommendations, which we have done. Since the accident in 2008. Our aircraft that you see there has every recommendation and then some, okay? Most of the equipment recommendations that the NTSB put out aren't required to be installed until 2017, 2018, but we meet them all. This aircraft meets them all, which we're very proud of, that we were able to spec it out before it became regulatory. We had already planned this, because retrofit would have been hell. You know, to retrofit this thing with certain pieces of equipment. So we're very pleased with that. But, you know, we're just one part of the program. Yes, sir.
How do you all compare with the rest of the states and the nation? I'm not familiar with that.
United well, some states have, like Pennsylvania, some of their police, or the state, Pennsylvania State Police has an aviation unit, and some of them do medevacs, but they close up shop at 2. And we've done many medevacs outside of 30 miles from Maryland and took PA residents to our hospitals. We do, believe it or not, that's one of the things about Cumberland, is that we do a lot of work for West Virginia as well, okay, because they don't have a air medevac. We don't. And that was also being looked at, because we know there's a couple factors. We know that the 135, the direction to move towards 135 certainly is for the infrastructure for safety. Now, you know, we comply with those regulations. We meet the weather minimum standards and the like, and that's all wonderful, but we know that they can't subsidize the program if we're not certificated under 135. So I'm not saying that's the reason that we're continuing to pursue it, but that we know that they can't. We know that this aircraft is sucks a lot of money, a lot of fuel, and a lot of money to keep it. So that being said, whether that's coming down the line, we don't have any direction. That's not our job to say one way or the other. If they tell us to become one certificate under 135, we will. And we're very close to that. That's what I've been doing for the last 7 years, I think. Again, why I have so much gray hair. So we're finally getting to that point. They're going to make a decision now one way or the other, whether it's beneficial, the cost benefit of doing this. So it's interesting. Sir?
To tie on to that, what is the estimated cost per hour to operate?
It's about $6,000. $6,000 an hour. I mean, that's what we're using. Conklin and Decker is a group, a consultant group that does a lot of this type of work, and they found it to be a little bit less than that, but we find it to be more like $6,000 an hour to use this.
How big is your aviation section personnel-wise?
Right now we have, funny you should ask, I know we have 215. Now, of the 215, the way we plan it, it's about 5.7 pilots, okay, per section for a 12-hour section. We want 12-hour shifts. So it takes about 5.7 PICs and 4 SICs, okay, to complement a 24-hour section. So basically we have about 75 pilots, that's PICs and SICs, and about the same number of paramedics and rescue techs, and then the support staff as well. And a lot of our paramedics, typically state police, you just don't do one thing, you do many things. So paramedics or supervisors. John, who's been with us for years, did a lot of the AV work, a lot of productions, a lot of training videos, which are very, plus going to work at night, working a 12-hour shift, you know, trying to work one work, you know, during his shift. I mean, it just never ends. And that's one of the things about working with the state, is that you have to understand you're going to do multiple things.
What's the life expectancy of these aircraft?
Well, we got 20 some odd years out of the Dolphins, and as an aviator, I got a 1979 Grumman Cougar, okay, twin engine airplane. So really, if you keep them airworthy and you're changing them out, you're keeping up on the maintenance, there's no end game. The problem we had with the one of the reasons we had difficulty with the Dolphins were the three different models, and then anytime there was an upgrade. Because if we went to that 135 with the old aircraft, they would have to go through a conformity check, which would have been hellacious trying to get these things approved to make sure that everything was the way the FAA liked it when these were delivered to us, basically already checked for conformity. We had no issues there. And most of the time, getting the helicopters on the certificate is the difficult part. So we opted to hold off with the certification process until we got the AW139s. So really, I would think that, I think they're planning on about 25 years as we go through this.
So what are the odds you're going to be able to pick up the option for one or two of the, at the lower price?
Well, funny you should ask. We're discussing that now, and I think some paperwork has gone upstream.
Right.
But the we had an EMS work group after the accident in 2008. House Speaker Bush impaneled an EMS work group that were designed to look at the protocols, okay, as well as look at our basing, are the helicopters where they should be, the procurement of the new helicopters, and the pursuit of this CFR 135 certification. So that was all part of that work. Well, of course, we outlasted them. We outlasted Governor O'Malley, and they're at you know, they're either been ran out of office, or they didn't elect to run again, or move to different positions. So what they're trying to do is to re-embody this board for guidance to say, hey, here's what it takes for us to go CFR 135, and if you're not charging or subsidizing the flights, then why are we doing this? And here's if we stay a public aircraft operator. But if we go to CFR 135 and you don't support the operation with the required manpower, I mean, you know, people to do the filing, because we know that the FAA, they don't get you via ramp checks, they get you on the audits. So if they find out that something has been flown and hasn't been, you know, properly documented, and that the aircraft flew 10 times in that fashion, and that's $10,000 a hit, you know, that's 100 grand, fine, that the Maryland State Police would be levied at that point. And that could be 2 years later that this occurs when they do the audit. And that's a, that would be a consequence. Now, that's okay if you're bringing in revenue for the flights. Yeah. But again, they have to make that decision. That's not our decision. Personally, I think that everyone in the command prefers to do it the way we do it. And that is, you know, via the MSOL fund. That's why we can do as a public aircraft, because we're not being compensated for it. It's a government pot of money, if you would, as opposed to having any charge associated with it. That's why we don't do the inter-hospitals anymore. The Airline Deregulation Act is a big part of that. It's very difficult. Right now, the medical care can be dictated by the state of Maryland, but we can't dictate to MedStar that they need to have an AW-139 with two pilots, with TCAS, TALS, two radar altimeters, LPV capability, and a four-axis autopilot. We can't tell them that. As long as they have a 135 certificate, they can charge for their services. Now, we personally, I think, if you get hurt, and two people get hurt in this room, and state police picks up one, and MedStar picks up the other, well, you pay taxes as well. Why shouldn't you have two pilots, two paramedics, TCAS, you know, four-axis autopilot? Why should you be put in a Bell 407, which is a fine aircraft, but it's got a single engine? Or why don't you have two pilots in case the weather does get a little skosh out there and make a good decision? But that's something that I don't think the ADA was ever designed for air medical flights, helicopter air medical flights. But again, it was to increase the competition in the airline. And even though we're intrastate, not interstate for the most part, and the Airline Deregulation Act really deals with interstate, and we're still affected by it. There's been some moves because some folks aren't happy with paying $40,000 for a patient transfer. Some states have tried to do something about that. Now, it's not that bad here because the trauma stuff is on us, or, you know, we pay through your registration fee. So it's like a user fee if you think of it. But I'm sure everyone here knows someone that we've flown. And I'm sure you're glad that they're still around. You know, myself, you know, I've flown people, I've had friends and family flown by other pilots and paramedics within the organization. I couldn't have been prouder. You know, I'd have no qualms with flying anybody, you know, anybody in this age, in the Maryland State Police Aviation Command, flying anyone in my family. So, and I think that speaks volumes. But any other questions?
When did you stop using the Dolphin?
We actually phased out of the Dolphin once we took the first delivery of the first. Because now you know how state government goes, right? Well, you have six helicopters. Why aren't you flying them? Not that this is a technically advanced monster here that we need to learn, okay? And again, since we wouldn't take them, they said, well, you don't take them. You can't play with them. So the first time we got to actually get and develop the training, okay, for the transition. Now, all of our PICs went through a contract training, the manufacturer training program. So we were all type certificated like John. We all got a type rating. We never sat once in that helicopter. And we were all type rated. But we know that full flight simulators and aircraft fly a little bit different. So that all happened when we got six of them at once in February 2013. And then we started working on it. So we had to run a split fleet for a while. And then we started phasing out the ones that were timing out, we never put money into, and we put them on the side.
They're totally gone now.
They've all been auctioned off, yes, sir. They were sold at auction at various times, but the last one was actually moved out of the hangar. As a matter of fact, one of them went down. Oh, this is one of my, how that got in there. But one of them went to Australia. Hmm. And someone had said, may not have put it, but they painted it up real nice and pretty, and it still flies.
They get a nice price for them?
I don't want to go there. I don't want to go there. They did. I think there are some things that I think occurred. Generally, you have different departments of the state. You have Department of General Services. It wasn't the Maryland State Police. Mm-hmm. The money obtained from the sale of those didn't go back into Maryland State Police Aviation Command. It went into the general fund. Yeah. So all they do is see it as a task. Let's get rid of these things on eBay.
Yeah.
Okay? and you know they don't know anything about helicopters, but they know they can sell them. They got to sell them, so that's what they do. So the money's at, I mean, they certainly got several million for the lot. I don't know exactly the number because they sort of keep that away from us because they didn't come to us. We really didn't care at that particular point. But much like the Jet Rangers, you know, I mean, they give them away too, I'm sure. As a matter of fact, the one of the Hueys, of course, that was, we actually purchased that. That wasn't a giveaway. Was involved in an accident. Vic Morrow of the Twilight Zone, that was our Huey, took his head off.
If you remember,
combat. Yes, yes. Yeah, that was our, one of our Hueys.
Was it really?
Yes, it was. Yeah, that was in there. But that's you know, that's an aside there. He got out. Of course, he was in a place he shouldn't have been, and you know, things happen. But that's another reason probably why you're tied up on 175, you know, you know, waiting to get on. But any other questions, I can respond. Any for John? Oh, you still remember that you were a paramedic.
I retired for years.
Yes, sir.
Thanks for coming out tonight.
Anything for Helen. I'm telling you, as far as the DPE and John, any questions as far as that's concerned? I know we do a lot of support pilot stuff here. I mean, Helen brings in a great group of instructors. I know John, I'm a pinch hitter. I consider this John's area, and John will call me and say, hey, you know, he's sick and I can help, I will, okay? You know, but we all, you know, John's here and he works with the pilots here, he works with Helen. If someone needs me, I'll come down. I have no problem with that. I mean, the whole idea that we work for you, and if you've worked hard enough to become a student pilot and then be ready for a private pilot, a sport pilot, a recreational pilot, then we, that's what we do. You know, we want to see you reach your goal because we know how important that is to you and how few people really do it. I mean, when you're looking at tens of millions of people in this country with about 750,000 that have certificates and not all of them are flying, I mean, not many people can do what we do, right? And I mean, to get to the solo point, I think is pretty incredible. You know, John's got the military background, flew for the airlines, a wealth of experience. I did it through the general aviation fashion, as I mentioned. I was fortunate to go through the state police. And again, I was the last person hired that didn't have 2,000 hours. And I was, that went into effect January 1st, January 1st, and it was 1986. And January 1st, 1987, you had to have 2,000 hours. I was transferred into the Aviation Command on December 31st, 1986. So I was 24 hours away from having to meet that criteria. And I got trained, you know, I was a CFI before I went in, but that was all instructional. So I was trained in our Jet Rangers doing our mission. And that's the way I learned. And I think I did a great job. I mean, I was trained well. And I've really benefited from that because now what we do is we get folks that were learned, you know, they chase bugs, they do tours, they flight instruct, all of them are very noble. Now you put them into a $12 million helicopter as advanced as this. If you're flying a Robinson, 2,000 hours in a Robinson, really. You know, we had to turn with the Coast Guard, the AA-65s, those guys were retiring with 1,500 hours. They couldn't qualify to fly in our aircraft, which was the same aircraft that they flew because they didn't have 2,000 hours. That's the other extreme of the continuum, okay? As opposed to saying, hey, we got to take some allowances. We got a lot of talent here. We can take this guy chasing bugs in an R-22 that's got 2,000 hours, but we can't take this gentleman that just retired from the Coast Guard with 1,600 hours in AA-65 aircraft. We can't take him. And that's what we had to work with. Because anything seen as dumbing it down or reducing the requirements was frowned upon. But anything else? Yes, ma'am.
Who does make the actual, so if someone calls 911, who makes the call that?
Excellent question. Well, basically what happens is the field providers, whatever area they're in, would make the call. They would go through an assessment. If it meets a criteria, either damage or injury, okay, at that point, then they contact the appropriate facility through theirs. Now, I'm not familiar with all the local stuff.
So, but it's on the scene triage?
It is.
Okay.
And then SysCom, our System Communication Center, gets the call. Okay, they've edited again to make sure it meets the criteria.
X, Y, and Z.
Exactly. And then what they do, we have a CAD system that knows where all the helicopters are, and this is one of the results of the accident is to make sure that we know where everybody is at all times. And they will dispatch the helicopter that's got the best ETA. Now, what we have to prevent is rushing out the door. The NTSB, the hair stands on the back of their neck when they hear anything about shoot time. That golden hour, when you have seven sections, an aircraft that fly 145 knots, okay, you don't have to get out of the door in 10 minutes or 5 minutes, okay, and be in the air, okay, like you do in the military, right? They're already having a bad day, right? And if you don't get there, it's going to be a worse day, or you can't go, it's going to be a worse day. So we get out, the aircraft's already pre-fly, they pull it out. If it's 10, 15 minutes, it is what it is. We get there at that point. Whoever would have the best ETA. So again, just because East End covers this area, that doesn't mean that they're the closest. If someone's already airborne, they may dispatch Trooper 1 that's out of Baltimore because they're coming back from another mission and they could do it. So that's their job. And then they dispatch it at that point. Now, then SysCom has to look at, the flight crew has to do a risk analysis, okay? And they look at the weather, they look if they're tired. I mean, we consider all that. Everything that you see now being advertised, we do. The duty officer has to concur, that they concur that, yeah, okay, we think everything, yeah, we agree, okay, we'll go launch. And they launch, and then we get on scene at that point. Now, the paramedic has a lot of judgment. If he feels that the patient's better served going to a different facility, they can make that call, and they often do. Or if there's a delay, if someone's on the pad, you know, and they feel they got to get here, or whether we can circle and wait, they'll make those calls. But it always starts at the local area first, and then it goes through a series of checks and balances before we actually go airborne.
Do you have data linked to the hospital and for patient data?
We have communications capability, but we don't have. I mean, we're working towards that, but they don't. They don't do the monitoring yet, like the AMBOs do.
Yeah.
But we see that capability. We're really looking into helicopter flight data monitoring as well. We didn't know it's a transport category aircraft. One of the NTSB recommendations was, in fact, to develop proactive ways of assessing performance. And we found out that this is a great way of doing it. Right now we have a multifunctional flight data recorder / cockpit voice recorder. Well, it's very problematic to get that information. We're still using it reactively. But there are certain things now with the data link where we can upload this information and then send aircraft data, parameters, you know, torque, high rates of descents, and things of that nature. So that would be hand in hand with that type of telemetry capability. So it may be around the corner, but right now it's all done via the FM frequencies and consults and things of that nature. So they are in communication. They can be given orders to push different drugs and things of that nature. So. It's pretty impressive what they do in the back there. I always wanted to be the bus driver. I didn't want to be in the back with all that blood and stuff, man. I just want to drive the bus. That's it. Amanda, did you have another question?
I hear them a lot. I live on Route 8, and it seems like it's always out, and it's $6,000 an hour.
Well, now it's always out. Now, remember, there's two times it...
I'm just thinking, wow.
There's two times it's out. It's either on a mission, okay, by that it's either a flight operation for law enforcement, search and rescue, or it's training.
Okay.
And we're not an aggressive operation, meaning like Baltimore City, they're out flying 4 hours. They're looking for things. We're like the locals that get a call, then we go at that point, but we have to be prepared to go.
Okay, so the training, because I know sometimes you hear it maybe just because of the airport around here,
yep.
And it just sounds so close.
Yep. They'll do that. Now they should be flying. Now if you have, now again, they are allowed. And
allowed.
We try to fly, we try to fly friendly, and we try to maintain 1,000 feet. And sometimes, we forget, and little nudges from the public to say, you know, boy, it's been awful loud lately.
Okay.
We'll get them back in groove. Okay. So, and believe me, it does. I mean, it's got a, it is a helicopter. It does make noise, and we don't train at night.
We never do.
Okay. We do some instrument work, but we won't do pattern work and things of that nature. Okay, because of the risk is higher at night, more things can go wrong at night. So generally at nighttime, if we're out of your house at 6 a.m, someone's having a worse day than you are. You know, at that point, somebody's out there. You'd be surprised. You know, there somebody's not having a good day, or we're looking for somebody and that kind of thing. As a matter of fact, just a little story here before I leave. It'll show you how neat. Naive I was. I was coming back in a Bell Jet Ranger, and of course next to Martin was a friend of mine's house. He lived in Bowley's Quarters, and it was a hot summer day, and sun was going down, and we were flying right over his house to get to Martin State Airport. So I hit the light on his house, and then I just went and landed. Well, the next day I came over, and I said, "Wow, you know, I stopped by yesterday." He said, "Shh." I said, "What's wrong?" He said, "The lady next door thought there was a bad guy in the area. She locked the door and hid under the bed all night." And, you know, and I'm thinking, oh my God, I didn't even think of that. You know, I didn't even think of that. Here they find her, you know, heat stroke or something like that, and she thought there was a bad guy because I lit my friend's house up. You know, and again, you share that story because you don't think that would happen. You know. But it would, and we there are many stories like that where guys, man, we'd only consider that. So now we're all very respectful of the amount of money that it costs, but also the other part of it is you want your pilots to be proficient, and we have to maintain that proficiency. That's one of the other things. We do so much more than a 135 operator does, and I'm only saying that because we, you know, we don't turn a blade for a buck. They are very cognizant of the expense it costs, and they do whatever they have to do. We do whatever we need to do to maintain this. And the NTSB says we need to train to proficiency. So we don't do just the minimum. We make sure that they all meet the criteria. They don't fly for us. As simple as that. Yes, ma'am.
I'm a bit perplexed as to why the fire department always meets you guys out here.
Well, and that's a good point. There's a couple reasons for that, because most of the time the ambulance, that's part of their protocol, that they come and they set up in case there's a problem with the accident scene itself. But it also gives us a benefit in case there's a problem with us. If something should happen to where, you know, we have an engine problem, we catch fire, we have a hard landing, we already have the equipment there. So it's pretty much routine protocol. And they set up the LZ. Albeit not as well sometimes as we like, because we just had one where, you know, we're landing, here comes a car that can't wait, you know, goes right underneath the rotor disc, you know. So again, we still have those issues. And a lot of that is with the turnover from the volunteers and even some of the paid folks. So they just don't think, you know, they're so enthralled by looking at this helicopter, and these other people, they come up and watch and they want to take pictures. And you're at nighttime, we got night vision goggles that are snapping pictures, you know, that's all it takes. You know, then you lose all your night vision. So, you know, and we work, you know, they do a great job. They do the best they can do, and that's part of our system. So there, a lot of these folks are doing it. They're out there 3 o'clock in the morning when they could be with their families. So we appreciate everything that they do. Any other questions, sir?
Trooper Mike, thanks for your service.
Well, thank you. No, I appreciate it. You guys pay me. I mean, I enjoy it. I really appreciate it. Thanks for your time. Thanks for coming in.